went and took up a contract without remembering that our all-night is going to be that Friday. And because I needed some money to do some project, I took extra contract. And the season I am in my business, I can't disappoint them. So when I found out that I've already accepted the contract, and Jimmy reminded me of the all night, I said, no worries, we'll take this money to do our, by his special grace. But I wouldn't want to keep you unaware of what our team is this month of November. What is today's date?
29.
So we are still in October. So I will use this money section to deal with our team. The Archbishop has declared the team of November 2017 as our month of empowerment to walk in love. To walk in love. It's okay. Amen. Okay.
Amen.
Okay. Our Archbishop has declared our month of November as our month to walk in love.
In love?
In love. In love. Does you really understand what it means when God asks you to walk in love? Who can help us? What are the things that we should be expecting when God asks us to walk in love? Yeah.
Maybe there might be challenges or like hate showing towards you, and therefore you have to respond, not repaying people for you.
Okay, let's see if we can go through the scriptures Mama gave. John chapter 13, verse 34. Can you go there? Can you help us, please? Yeah, 12, 13, 34.
And I read. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another.
Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2.
Walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
That's the place that is near. Near to what you expect. Read it again. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2.
And walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling Savior.
Okay, can you read 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13?
Now read. Verses 13. And now abide in faith. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, which is love. These three, but the greatest of these is charity.
The greatest is what? Charity. Now, what should you expect if God is telling you that in the month of November, you have been empowered to walk in love? What should you expect? Because if God says there's going to be harvest, you should be expecting to sow seed. That's the instruction. Now God is saying, walk in love. And I said it's Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, that came close to what you should expect. Okay, read John chapter 15, verse 13.
Now read.
Yes.
Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend.
So what should you be expecting? What is God expecting for you when he said love?
Maybe give that expectation.
Read that, is there. Why can't you interpret the Bible? You read it now.
Greater love hath no man than this. Okay. That a man lay down his life for his friend.
So what is there? You still do not understand.
Just lay down your life for your friend.
What does that mean?
Die.
Is he sleeping for your friend? So if God is saying love, he's saying be ready to die. God is saying, he said that's the highest level of love. So to forgive is little. He said not only forgive, but die. Do you know, if anyone is faithful, and if truly I'm a man of God called by God, and you are faithful under my ministry, do you know attacks that will destroy you cannot come to you? It will come to me first. So that's the proof that I love you. If I'm always praying for you, if I'm always the one stopping the enemy, praying and interceding on your behalf, anything dead will target me. Because they know, because the Lord cannot do anything without revealing to his prophet. That was what Jesus did. To show you how much I love him, to show you, I took up the sentence of death. So if I must prove. Now, how many of us are doing that? Let's, husband and wife, marriages. How many of us are doing that? We are counting if our wives or our husbands make mistakes, we write it down. And, you know, he has done it again. He has done it again. He want to do it again. Don't you know who I am? Don't you know what, you know? Why should you do that to me? Don't I get what I'm saying now?
Yes, sir.
So, I just want to use this opportunity to announce to us what our bishop has declared the month of November. So, as you're entering into November, remember, it's a season you have to show love. How do you show the love? That. But I want to tell you, if you can truly forgive, if you can truly forgive, if you can truly forgive one another, you are doing the right thing. God bless you. Let's pray. Father, Lord, I thank you for this morning section. I thank you for what the Archbishop has declared the month of November, which I have declared to your people, O God. Lord, I ask, O God, for your grace. Among these many challenges to be able to deliver your word. Among these many distractions, oh God, to be able to deliver your word this morning. And be able to concentrate towards heaven. Lord, I ask, oh God, for the grace. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, as we are going to go into prayers. Not actually because of the word that has been declared by the Archbishop for the month of November, but because of the revelation I had this morning. Lord, I decree, but the Bible says, because the Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Lord, help us to fight and be victorious at last. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Do you know the proof that you've really found God? One of the proofs that you have really had an encounter with Jehovah. Who can share with us? You know, when you share like this, you will not forget it. Who can tell me the proof? One of the proofs that you've really had an encounter. It happened in the midst of all the apostles. Is there anyone that want to help us? You know, something changed in them. Something began, you know, started happening in them.
Yeah.
Yeah, what's that?
Is that when you go through experience of God himself, you know, like shows some signs and wonders in your life, like, how do I put it? It's like having personal encounter, like the things that God has done for you, like, showing you that.
Do you have an example in the Bible, anyone that really... Yeah, talk, see.
Yeah, for example, take Peter, someone like Peter.
Yep.
Like, first of all, though he worked with Jesus and all that stuff, like, he doubted him.
Mm-hmm.
But then when he had, like, an actual encounter, like, when he was really convicted, like, for example, with Paul, he no longer considered his life, for example, as anything precious to him, but he only wanted to live for Christ. He was not, like, no longer fearful. He was, like, really convicted. He was, like, strengthened in faith, and he was really bold. He gained that boldness to bold, like, proclaim the gospel to even those that even persecuted Christ. So I think when you have that personal encounter with God, like, you no longer consider your life as precious to yourself, but you just want to live for him.
Beautiful. That's one of it, but it's not the answer I need. So who can share another one? You know, it's an experience you never get through bookshops. Whenever I say bookshop, it's reading the books of other men or listening to men. It's an experience you only get by leaving the book. And in our generation now, we have changed a lot of things from the book. There's only a few ministers that are still preaching the book today. Because we want to give, instead of proclaiming what God wants us to hear, we now want to give the word reason why we should constitute in our sins, in our foolishness, in our laziness. That's what we do in the church today. That is what we call it. What do they call the teaching of the new generation now? Motivational speaker. They've changed the meaning. We don't proclaim the word of God any longer. We motivate people to live the way they are to be. We have removed guilt from the Bible. We are now fighting sorrow in the Bible. You know, we don't. The right thing is, what has God said? Boom. Proclaim it. Don't give people reason why they should be living the way they are living. The first, any man of God that has submitted himself, or a Christian, because the more you submit yourself, the more Jesus reveals God to you, reveals Jehovah. You know, that's the only thing Jesus came. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes to the Father. He said, you only came to reveal the Father to us. And do you know the truth? No one will ever see Jesus. No one will ever see the Father except Christ. So if anybody in Christ, you are ready for it. Or you are crucified in Christ, you have died in Christ. Where Christ is here. Church, am I making sense? I get what I'm saying. The first thing, if you touch that realm, is you want to die. You want to go to heaven. If you touch that realm, you don't want to. What are you doing on earth? The first, I'm telling you, it happened, Stephen. When they wanted to crucify Stephen, they opened. They were wondering, why is he rejoicing? He said, forgive them. They don't know they have paid my ticket to heaven now. His eyes opened, he saw heaven, he saw Jesus sitting at the right hand. He said, is that where I'm coming now? So if they kill me now, so that's where I'm coming now. Oh, he said, oh God, oh Lord. Oh, forgive them, they have done the best for me. So I'm leaving this wicked world. So I'm not going to my throne. foresee. It's better for me to die than to live. See, the only good reason why I like living is people, because nobody can get born again until they see somebody born again around them. For me to live is Christ. So that many will still get born again. So let me put it to you. If you don't have a family like my family, Pastor Joseph, what are you hoping? What are you doing here? Somebody has to be visible. You have to be checking his life. You have to be watching him for you to be until you are mature. You walk with one leg. You try sometimes two legs. You pinch on somebody's back. And that is why many are not getting born again any longer. Because the pastors preaching born again are not even born again. Does that make sense? The pastors that are preaching born again today, they are not even born again. If you have an encounter with Jehovah, if you ever, the first thing is, yeah, so there's a place. When Paul went to God heaven, he never, every of his prayers, until the one day he saw his crown, he saw a vision, he saw his crown. He didn't even wait. He said, Timothy, don't worry, my life has been poured out like water. I'll be leaving you soon. Eh? Take care. He started handing over. One man of God said, the proof that I'll prove to you is that heaven is real. Very wealthy man. He said, I want people to come. I will will everything that belongs to this church, that belongs to my family, that belongs to this church, I will will it to you. Immediately the trumpet sound is all yours. Wait and be alive. I will will it to you. I'll sign it immediately because the trumpet will definitely sound. It's going to be my sign tomorrow or my next. So because you want to live on earth, I want to will it to you. Bring your lawyer that will be alive. Don't bring a Christian because that Christian will be taken. You will not be alive to confirm it. Bring your kind that doesn't believe that heaven is real. And I will sign it because it will definitely happen one day. One day. Glory, keep that for you. One day it will definitely happen. It will. So I will sign agreement, have everything, take it. Now, why I'm saying all these things is you can never portray love without trust. You can never love anybody without trust. Is it possible? For any human being, it's very, very impossible for anybody to love without trust. What is love? Serving sacrificially without expectation. If God says, I love you, God is not expecting anything. God is not expecting you to be righteous. God is not expecting you to be faithful. He said, I've loved you, for God so loved the world that he gave. That was why he loved us while we were yet sinners. Because there wasn't an expectation. But God wouldn't have done it without trust. What was the trust that made God to do it? He trusted his son. What did his son tell him? His son said, I am going to bring back this to you. And his son was the precious thing, the most precious thing he had. He loved with trust on Jesus to bring back his family to him. And what is trust? Trust is serving sacrificially with expectation. With expectation. With expectation. So how can you love? How can I love you, my members? Sincerely. I will only love you sincerely by trusting God. Serving with expectation from God. I'm serving you without expectation, which is love. I show you love, then I trust God. And do you know why I have to trust God? Because Apostle Paul said, we have this sentence of death. You die daily. If you must love the people, you must die daily. Now, this death is not the only death that occurs to any child of God. If you obey the principles of God, if you obey the principles of God, you will never have any negative debt. What I mean by negative debt, debts that you created to yourself through your mistakes, not the debt you created because of your love. You know, my teachings might not make sense to you now because you are not in that level yet. But you see, the time is coming very, very soon. You will start on that. You see how you're dragging my teachings from YouTube? Because that one will start making sense to you. There are two types of death we encounter in our walk with God, trying to please God. The first one is the death that we encounter because of our love for Christ. And the other death is when we break the principle. Does that make sense? There's another death when we break the principle. If you live the principle of the Word of God every day, every month, every year, you don't need prayers. Your life will just be walking smoothly. Because you're just following the principle in the Word of God. Does that make sense? Now, the death, there's no greater love than this, that a man should give his life for his friends. That death